Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
As if you were here this morning, you're aware of the fact that we covered a lot of material, and I want to review just a few points and enlarge on a few points that we studied this morning, but then I want to go into something that if you find the answer to this, you're welcome to tell me. I've been wondering about it for years, but I have never found the answer to this question in the Bible. But Ellen White is very specific in the book Great Controversy about what this biblical term means. And it's a biblical term that we studied this morning in Acts, the third chapter, when Peter's talked about the times of refreshing. Did you remember that? Acts 3:19? Peter talked about the times of refreshing. And when that happens, your sins are going to be blotted out. And if your sins aren't blotted out during that time, you're not going to heaven. And so just because we can't explain exactly how or what is involved or what it means for a person's sins to be blotted out, we still want to study and understand everything that we can about it. And you want to have the assurance that when the times of refreshing come, that your sins will be blotted out. Because that has to happen if you're going to go to heaven. So we're going to look at that phrase, the times of refreshing. I'm going to read to you from the Great Controversy. Ellen White tells us exactly what period of time that's talking about. But before we do that, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to study from His Word. Father in heaven, we thank You for the Bible. We thank You for the exciting, electrifying hope that we have in Jesus, that we know that He is coming back to this world soon, and that He is going to take all that are ready back to the Father's house. And Lord, we pray that this evening as we study about this period of time that is rapidly approaching, just before the coming of Christ, when our sins will be blotted out, when the times of refreshing come, we earnestly pray that You'll help us now as we study to understand what is involved in being ready for our sins to be blotted out. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's review just a few points that we studied this morning. First of all, before sins can be blotted out, whether you're talking about an individual, the soul temple, or whether you're talking about the church, or whether you're talking about the sanctuary in heaven, all three of those things were referred to as temples. In addition to that, there was the temple, of course, of the Old Covenant. So there's four temples or sanctuaries mentioned in the Bible we studied this morning. And in each of these temples, the sins are to be blotted out, but in order for the sins to be blotted out, they have to be cleansed. There has to be work of judgment, and the sins are blotted out at the end of the time of judgment. And we read that this morning from the book Great Controversy, page 485. Let's read just a few texts review what we were talking about. First of all, let's look at the sanctuary in heaven. Before the sins can be blotted out, there has to be a work of judgment or investigation. Whose sins are going to be blotted out? Whose sins are not going to be blotted out? So the blotting out of sin comes at the end of the investigative judgment. The investigative judgment began in 1844, and that's called the cleansing of the sanctuary in Daniel 8:14, and the blotting out of sin occurs at the end of that period. We are still in that period. But at the end of the investigative judgment, at the period that we call the close of probation, or while probation is closing, sins will be blotted out. We read about that in Great Controversy, page 485. Now, we also saw that if we take texts that apply to the church as the temple of God, or to an individual Christian as the temple of God, and we flip those on in, those texts cannot be applied in the same way as texts that are referred to the sanctuary in heaven. The sanctuary in heaven began to be cleansed in 1844. The judgment began, and when we say began to be cleansed, when the judgment began, the sins of those that had died in Christ, their sins were blotted out. Sins began to be blotted out of the dead in October 22, 1844. That's when that began. The sins of the dead were blotted out. And Ellen White says Christ started at Adam and the first generation, and He moves up generation to generation. By the way, this is a work that is beyond our comprehension. If you've ever been to a court, I've told you before that I was here at a court in Wichita. I was asked to do jury duty, and I was there. And it took all day long just to select the jury. I was very happy I wasn't selected to be part of the jury, but I had to sit through the selection process. And then after that, there's going to be a trial for 1 or 2 days with this person. The person that I was called to be jury duty was a person that was arrested for drunk driving, and they were protesting that they were innocent and weren't really drunk. And to try one like that takes a court about 2 days. And that's just one case. And, of course, they have many courts, because otherwise they'd never cover the cases. But in sanctuary, there's just one court, and they cover hundreds of thousands of cases per day. Maybe they cover even more than that. Just figure it out for yourself. When you look clear back to the beginning of time, all of God's children, all down through the ages, and then the selection process, and every case, Ellen White says every case is investigated as carefully and closely as if that was the only person that lived on the earth. And yet they're covering millions and millions of cases. And how they can do the volume of the work that they do in the time that we're talking, we have no comprehension. It's a divine system that we cannot even comprehend. But that began in 1844. Now, when we talk about the cleansing of the church. When did some people have taught that the cleansing of the church began in 1844? Well, wait a minute. The Bible's very clear, and we read some texts this morning. God has been cleansing His church for thousands of years. Back in Ezekiel 36:25, did I read that text this morning? He talks about He's going to cleanse His people. He says, I'm going to cleanse you. You're going to be clean. And in Ephesians 5:26, it talks about the church being cleansed without spot or wrinkle. And in 2 Timothy 2:20 and 21, it talks also about this cleansing. It talks about it's taking place in present tense. So the church, God has been cleansing His people for thousands of years. However, it is true that during the time of the investigative judgment, there is to be a special cleansing among God's people. Let's just read that in the Bible. If you have your Bible, we'll just read one text. Look in Malachi, the third chapter. And notice what it says. Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to His temple. Now, this is not the second coming. This is what happened in 1844. Will suddenly come to His temple, even the messenger of the covenant, in whom you delight. Behold, He is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of His coming, and who can stand when He appears? For He is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasant to the Lord as in the days of old, as in former years. And I will come near to you in judgment. See, he's talking about the judgment. I will be a swift witness against sorcerers, against adulterers, against perjurers, against those who exploit wage earners and widows and the fatherless, and against those who turn away an alien because they do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. So, God has been cleansing His church for thousands of years, but there is to be a special cleansing of God's people, His church, during the time of the judgment. Now, we see that very clearly in Malachi 3. That's not the only passage in the Bible that talks about that. And then third, the cleansing of the soul temple. Now, we saw this morning that it has been God's will in every age for His children to have their soul temple cleansed. Paul said, and we read the text, 2 Corinthians 7. He says, let us perfect holiness in the fear of God, which cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of flesh and spirit. That's present tense. That was in the apostolic age. That's 2 Corinthians 7:1. But that was true in the Old Testament too. Isaiah said to those that are in God's service, and said, you need to be clean. Touch no unclean thing. That's Isaiah 52:11. David talked about it. Maybe you'd like to see what David said about it. It was true in David's time, too, that God was cleansing His people. Look in Psalm 51. Look in verse 2. It says, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Look at verse 7. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Look in verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. So David understood that God wanted His people to be clean. He said, you want truth in the inward parts. You want a people that are clean, that are pure. David was afraid of this at this time that he had committed the unpardonable sin, and he pleaded with the Lord. He says, please don't take the Holy Spirit from me. It's right here in this psalm. But cleanse me. Purify me. I want to be clean. I want to be purged. So God has been in the cleansing business of cleansing souls from sin ever since the beginning. That is not something that started in 1844. Peter talked about it. We read what John said about it. The blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from every sin, 1 John 1:7. Paul wrote about it in Colossians 3:9-11. So in every age, God has been purifying a people to Himself, and it has been God's people have been purified. However, it is also true that there is to be a special work of cleansing among God's people during the time of the judgment. And Isaiah talks about that very clearly. If you'd like to turn to Isaiah 3 and 4. In Isaiah 3, it says in Isaiah 3, verse 13 and 14, it says, "The Lord stands up to plead and stands to judge the people. The Lord will enter into judgment with the elders of the people." So this is talking about the judgment. And what is going to be the result of the judgment? Well, it says that in Isaiah 4:4, that the Lord's going to wash away the filth of the daughters of Zion and purge the blood of Jerusalem from her midst by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burning. And the result is, you see in verse 3, everyone that's left among the living in Jerusalem is going to be holy. So, the soul temple is to be cleansed, and this is a work that has been in process among God's people for thousands of years. The church is to be cleansed. God has been cleansing His people, His church, for thousands of years. But there is to be a special work of purification and cleansing among God's people in His church during the time of the judgment, which began in 1844. Now, at the end, we already studied this, at the end of the judgment, I better read it again, is at the end of the investigative judgment, at the end of the Day of Atonement, that sins are blotted out. And remember, your sins have to be blotted out if you're going to go to heaven, period. There's no other way. That's for you and for me, for every one of us. Our sins must be blotted out. This is another way you can say it is, they must be removed. All right, let me read that statement from my Great Controversy 485. And then let's look for a few minutes at this time when the sins are blotted out, and whose sins will be blotted out, and whose sins will not be blotted out. Ellen White has quite a bit to say about this. And this is something that I would be a little hesitant to present to a large service or many visitors and non-Adventists who are present, because I'm going to depend for some of my evidence on evidence that I have only been able to find in the book Great Controversy by Ellen White. I can't prove this actually from the Bible. The Bible doesn't contradict it, but I can't prove it from the Bible. But in Great Controversy, I'll show you, it's very, very clear exactly when the sins are going to be blotted out. And Peter refers to it in Acts 3. Now here's what it says in Great Controversy, page 485. "The work of the investigative judgment and the blotting out of sins is to be accomplished before the second advent of the Lord." Now see, the thing that's scary about this is that there's so many people that are expecting, even though they know that they're living in sin, they know they're breaking the commandments, they expect that when the Lord comes, He's going to cleanse them and blot everything out. But what did this statement say? If your sins are going to be blotted out, when are they going to be blotted out? They're going to be blotted out before Jesus comes. It says, "Since the dead are to be judged out of the things written in the books, it is impossible that the sins of men should be blotted out until after the judgment at which their cases are to be investigated." So notice, the sins cannot be blotted out until after the judgment. In other words, at the end of the judgment. But the Apostle Peter distinctly states that the sins of the believers will be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and He's from sending Jesus Christ, Acts 3, 19 and 20. When the investigative judgment closes, Christ will come and His reward will be with Him to give to every man as his work shall be. So here is the question that we want to study. First of all, when is the time? Let's look at Acts 3, 19 and 20. We ask this question, when is the time when the sins are blotted out? Now we know it's at the end of the investigative judgment, the Day of Atonement. And what are the conditions for your sins and for my sins to be blotted out? What are the conditions? All right, Acts 3, 19 and 20. Says, "Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that He may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before." Now, this statement is explained clearly. By the way, I have tried to search all through the Bible to find out if there is any explanation in the Bible itself for this expression, the times of refreshing. I've searched the concordance, I've searched my Bible, I cannot find it. If any of you have found it or can find it, I'm not saying it's not there, I would be in your debt if you would tell me. If there's any explanation in the Bible itself for the times of refreshing that Peter's talking about, please tell me. I've searched all through the Bible, I cannot find it. So I generally only preach during worship services about things that I can just show you point blank from the Bible. So I'm going to talk about something now that I personally cannot show you point blank from the Bible, but I can show you from the book Great Controversy. And I'm going to read to you now how Ellen White explains in the book Great Controversy this expression, the times of refreshing. And by the way, it's important to understand this if you read Ellen White's writings, because in the book Early Writings and many other places, she just refers to the refreshing over and over and over again, and she doesn't tell you what she's talking about. So if you don't know, then you don't know. But in this statement of Great Controversy, she will tell you her understanding of what the times of refreshing are. This is in Great Controversy, starting on page 611 and going into 612. This is what she writes. The great work of the gospel is not to close with less manifestation of the power of God than marked its opening. The prophecies which were fulfilled in the outpouring of the former rain at the opening of the gospel are again to be fulfilled in the latter rain. Now, the prophecies that were fulfilled in the early rain, the opening of the gospel that you read about in Acts 2, were the prophecy in Joel 2. We're not going to study that tonight, but that's very interesting. The prophecy in Joel 2, 28 to 32, Peter said, this day this prophecy is fulfilled. Ellen White says that prophecy is going to be fulfilled again. That's Joel 2, 28 to 32. That's very, very interesting prophecy. Something to look forward to. We won't study that now. And then she says this. Here are the times of refreshing to which the Apostle Peter looked forward when he said, repent ye therefore and be converted that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord and he shall send Jesus. Acts 3, 19 and 20. So when were the times of refreshing that Peter was looking forward to? Let me read the prior sentence again. Here's what it says. The prophecies which were fulfilled in the outpouring of the former rain at the opening of the gospel are again to be fulfilled in the latter rain at its close. Here are the times of refreshing to which the Apostle Peter looked. So the times of refreshing are when? It's the time of the latter rain. The times of refreshing are the time of the latter rain. And it is during this time period, that your sins are going to be blotted out. And your sins have to be blotted out during this time period. Otherwise, you will never be in the kingdom of heaven. Nobody will be in the kingdom of heaven whose sins are not blotted out. And let's take the dead. The people that are dead, their sins are blotted out after they die. But right before the close of probation, people's sins are going to be blotted out who are still alive. Now, how do we prepare so that we're ready for our sins to be blotted out during this period of time, the latter rain? I want to read to you a number of statements that I have found in the Spirit of Prophecy where she talks about preparing so that your sins would be blotted out. You want your sins blotted out? I want my sins blotted out. Just remember, friends, that during this period of time, if your sins are not blotted out, you are not going to heaven. Nobody's going to be taken to heaven who has sin within. Sin has to be blotted out. Now, I mentioned this morning, this is what the whole controversy was about. In the time on the theories that were advocated by Robert Brinsby, he tried to explain what this involved, the blotting out of sin. I've heard lots of people try to explain it, write about it, write books. And my advice to you is, don't try to explain something that God hasn't explained. Whatever God explains, that's fine. But what God hasn't explained, there are a lot of things in the Christian religion that God has not explained. And if God hasn't explained it, well, then we need to leave it alone. Moses said, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but those things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever. So what God has explained about the blotting out of sins, we can study and learn and believe. But he hasn't explained how and what it is. If he has, I've never been able to find it. And back in the 70s, I searched everywhere I could find to try to find it. I don't think it's inspired writings. The Lord hasn't told us. But because the Lord hasn't told you how something works, that doesn't mean you can't experience it. I've told you before the experience I had when I was in graduate school. There was a lady physician who especially was in digestion. She taught in the medical school at Loma Linda. And we had a class from her. And she told us this. She says, there is no human being in the world that really understands how digestion takes place. I thought, that's interesting. But you know what? I didn't stop eating. Just because I can't explain how digestion takes place, and just because nobody else in the world can explain how digestion takes place, we can still eat and we can still experience digestion and still live. It's the same way with blotting out of sins. You can't explain it. Don't try to explain exactly how it works and what it involves. Just leave that with the Lord. He's going to do it. But you can experience it even if you can't explain it and don't understand all about it. And we want to understand, what are we to do so that our sins will be blotted out? So that's what we're going to look at right now. What can we do? Peter said, repent and be converted. By the way, the word that's translated be converted is a word that simply means to turn. I've met some people, and I'm sorry this is the case, but some people get very upset with modern translations because they say it just says turn and it should say converted. Well, what they don't understand is that the word converted comes from a word that means to turn around. That's what converted means. It means you turn around. You go in one direction, you turn around and go another direction. Well, that's what Peter said to do, to be ready. I want to read to you several statements what Ellen White wrote about this. She said, this is volume 9, page 154. She said, there are many among us who are deficient in spirituality and who, unless they are holy, that's completely converted, will certainly be lost. Can you afford to run the risk? You can't. I can't. We cannot afford to run the risk. She says, unless you're completely holy, converted, you'll end up being lost. You can't afford to take that kind of risk. Now, I'm a human being, so sometimes I hesitate to tell you everything the prophet wrote. When she wrote that, do you know what she was actually talking about? You know what her subject was? Health reform. Dietary reform. That's what she's talking about. And in that context, she said there's a lot of people among us that aren't totally converted. And if they're not, they're running the chance to be lost. You can read it yourself. Volume 9, page 154. Here's another one. This is in Gospel Workers, page 432. We profess a great and holy faith, and our character must be in accordance with that faith, with God's great moral standard. Now, notice what she advises us to do. Let us, number one, shun every mean action. Number two, all dishonesty. Number three, all overreaching. And if anyone is guilty of wrong in this respect, let him confess his sin and make restitution to the one whom he has wronged, and in addition, bring a trespass offering to God, that when the times of refreshing shall come, his sins may be blotted out and his name retained in the book of life. So did you get the points? She said we should shun every mean action, all dishonesty, all overreaching. You know what overreaching is. That's when, whether we're buying or selling, you know, if you buy and you want to get it for almost nothing, and if you're selling it, you want the price jacked up sky high. And so there's a lot of overreaching that takes place in business. All kinds of overreaching. She says we must shun every mean action, all dishonesty, all overreaching. By the way, in heaven, the angels don't act that way. And so we have to learn not to act that way. And she says, if we've been guilty of wrong in this respect, anybody, let him confess his sin and make restitution to the one whom he has wronged. So if I've wronged somebody by overreaching or by dishonesty or by some mean action, then I'm to tell them I'm sorry, and then I'm to make restitution, to pay them back whatever I wronged them, and then in addition to that, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to bring a trespass offering to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm sorry, I wronged one of my fellow servants, one of your fellow servants, and I've said I'm sorry, and I've tried to make restitution, but I did wrong, and I'm sorry, and I want to bring a trespass offering. She says, bring a trespass offering to the Lord. And the reason for this is why? Because the times of refreshing are coming. And when that happens, you want your sins to be blotted out. In the book, it's in One Selected Messages. It's actually from the Review and Herald. She wrote, I have no specific time of which to speak when the outpouring of the Holy Spirit will take place, when the mighty angel will come down from heaven and unite with the third angel in closing up the work for this world. My message is that our only safety is in being ready for the heavenly refreshing, having our lamps trimmed and burning. And then she goes on to talk how Jesus has told us that we're to be ready for in such a time that we think not. He's going to come. And when, by the way, in that context, when Jesus says, in such an hour as you think not, I'm coming, I hope this doesn't come to too great a shock to you. He's not actually talking about the second coming. He's not talking about the second coming. God's people will know exactly when the second coming is going to be, because before the second coming occurs, the day and hour is going to be announced from heaven, and you're going to know the exact day and the exact hour that he's going to come. But when Jesus says, I'm coming at an hour you don't expect, you know what he's talking about? He's talking about the close of the day of judgment, when everybody's future destiny, eternal destiny, is forever decided one way or the other, and the time comes and it's closed. That's the time Jesus is talking about. When he's going to come, you're not going to know. And when that time comes, you're either saved or lost. That is the time that Jesus is talking about in Matthew 24 and in Mark 13, where he says, you're going to come suddenly at a time you don't expect, when you're not, and so you need to be ready all the time. He's not talking about the second coming. He's talking about the close of the day of judgment, when everybody's destiny is decided, and he's talking about that very same time when sins are blotted out. Now, here's how Ellen White explains this. And it's in Three Selected Messages, 355. It's actually originally from the time, Signs of the Times. She says, when the times of refreshing, what's the time of refreshing refer to? Latter rain. That's the latter rain. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, then, that at that time, the time of the latter rain, the sins of the repentant soul who has received the grace of Christ and has overcome through the blood of the Lamb will be removed from the records of heaven. Now, right now, every sin that you have ever committed, whether it's thought, word, or action, every sin that you have ever committed is not just written in your own central nervous system. Don't start discussing that. That's what Brinsmead got into, and you can't explain it. Just let it alone. Let the Lord deal with that. But it's also recorded in the books of heaven. Right now, tonight, every sin that you have ever committed, it's all recorded in the books. Because judgment's not over yet. But when the judgment comes to an end, if you meet the qualifications, your sins will be removed. That's what we're talking about when we say the blotting out of sin. Your sin will be removed. Let me read the statement again. It says, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, then the sins of the repentant soul who has received the grace of Christ and has overcome through the blood of the Lamb will be removed from the records of heaven. What will happen to your sins when they are removed? Now, here's where our Protestant friends think that we're heretics, but this is Bible, this is Spirit of Prophecy. Here's what she says will happen. Will be removed from the records of heaven and will be placed upon Satan, the scapegoat, the originator of sin, and be remembered no more against him, that is, the repentant person, forever. That's what happens. That's how the sins are blotted out. That happens at the end of the Day of Atonement. The sins, your sins, that right now are in the books of heaven, they're all removed. And what it's done with them? They're placed on Satan. That's what she says. You can read it. Three Selected Messages, that's 355. and 356. Now, what do we need to be doing to prepare for that time? We need to be examining our hearts. We need to pray about this, friends. We need to say, Lord, is there anything in my heart, in my feelings, in my affections, in my thoughts, that's not right in your sight? Now, unconverted people tend to think that everything's pretty good. The reason they think that is because they're not in touch with Jesus. When you start to see Jesus in his spiritual character, to understand what he's really about, then it's when you begin to abhor yourself. You say, Isaiah said, Lord, I'm all undone. I'm ruined. I'm a man of unclean lips. I'm dwelling in the midst of a people of unclean lips, because he saw the Lord, and when he saw the purity of the Lord, he knew that he was ruined. And he knew that unless the Lord did something, there was no hope for him. And so he said, Lord, well, I do. I'm ruined. I'm unclean. And the Lord said, well, I'm going to take your uncleanness away from you. I'm going to purge you. I'm going to purify you. During the time of the judgment, God's people need to be reviewing their own hearts, their own lives. They need to be asking this question. They need to be asking this question to the Lord and say, Lord, are my thoughts in harmony with heaven, with the government of heaven, and with my Lord and Savior? Are my affections, my feelings, are they in harmony with Jesus and with the government of heaven? Or am I deceived, thinking that everything's all right when it's not all right? You remember the prayer that Jesus talked about in Luke 18, the Pharisee and the publican went up to pray, and the Pharisee came and he said, Lord, I thank you that I'm not like other men are. Adulterers and extortioners, or even like this publican over here, tax collector over here. And the tax collector, he came in, he knew, everybody thought that he was a very wicked man, and he thought that he was a very wicked man, and he wouldn't even look up. He bowed his head, and he beat on his breast, and he said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus made the statement then that the people that were listening were absolutely shocked and astonished, because they thought the Pharisees were the most holy of all people. Jesus said, the tax collector went down to his house justified, not the other man. You see, when we think that everything is all right or we're pretty good, that's proof that we're not in very close contact with Jesus. The Apostle Paul said, I know that in my flesh there dwells no good thing. It's not possible for me to think a good thought, or have a good feeling, or do a righteous action. Why? Now people say, the moralists say, oh, I can do some good things. Do you know what the problem is with their reasoning? Do you realize, friends, that unless the Holy Spirit is working in your mind and your heart, every thought, every word, every feeling grows out of your selfish heart. Selfishness, Ellen White says, is the strongest trait of our sinful, fallen human nature. And every thought and every feeling and every word stems from that, and therefore everything about you is defiled. Unless the Holy Spirit works a miracle inside. And we have to have that miracle worked inside of us every day, every moment. In fact, I was just reading today, it needs to be worked on us every hour, as the hours go by in the day. Holy Spirit has to be doing that. That's why she says here, how will our cases appear in the judgment? What is now our standing before God? Are we closely examining our own hearts? Are we, by repentance and confession, sending our sins beforehand to judgment, that they may be blotted out when the times of refreshing to come shall come? This is an individual work, a work which we cannot safely delay. We should take hold of it earnestly. Our salvation depends upon our sincerity and zeal. Let the cry be awakened in every heart, what must I do to be saved? So, that's the experience that we need to have. We need to be examining, searching our own hearts and saying, Lord, David did this one time. He said, Lord, is there any wicked way in me? Now, what was he talking about when he said, is there any wicked way in me? He had come to realize that unless the Holy Spirit should work in his heart and mind, that every thought, every feeling, every word, every action stemmed from selfishness and was therefore wicked. See, everything that we can do ourselves is wicked because it stems from selfishness. And selfishness, Ellen White said that she saw in vision that selfishness was the root of every other sin. It's the root. And it's so much a part of our human nature that unless the Holy Spirit works a miracle inside, when people start to see this, one of the first things that happens, the disciples had this experience, and they asked the Lord, they said, well, Lord, whoever's going to be saved then? Well, nobody's going to be saved except by a divine miracle that's worked out in their life. But the Lord wants to work that divine miracle out in your life. And if we ask him to, if we say, Lord, I realize, I hope you're having this experience. You're starting to realize that unless the Lord works a miracle in your life, that every thought, every word, every feeling, every action is wicked because it stems from selfishness. You know, I've told you this story before, but we have so much a part of us that we don't even think about it. We want recognition. And so, that's because we're selfish. We want recognition. There's no place in the Bible where Jesus was seeking recognition. And so, I had a friend. This is when I was living in Chehalis, Washington. Had a friend that graduated from Loma Linda, a physician. And so they sent him. They were raising money, and they wanted to raise money to build a new building, I think it was, at the medic school. And so they said to the people, now, if you give so much, then you can have a classroom named after you. If you give this much, you can have an amphitheater named after you. Actually, if you give this much, you can have the whole building named after you. So he was talking to me about all these different things. He did this much. Every time my wife and I are in Glendale, when I go to the Glendale Adventist Medical Center, they've got all these gold plaques. They've got the little ones for the people that gave, you know, maybe $5,000, and then the little bigger ones for the people to give $10,000, and the bigger ones for the people to give $25,000, and the great big ones for the people to give $50,000. And you know, if you give $1,000,000, then you'll have a great big picture of you, and plus a great big sign and everything about you. And then let's ask this question. Why are the people giving the money? Because they want their name on that thing. They want that reckoning. The Bible talks about that. It says about the wicked that are rich. It says they name their lands. They give them their name. They put their name on it because they want to be remembered. So, did they do it because they wanted to help somebody that was sick at this hospital? No. Oh, they did a wonderful thing, right? Well, they did it for selfishness. They did because they wanted some kind of recognition. If I'm doing what I'm doing because I want something in return, some kind of recognition for some selfish reason, there's nothing righteous about that. That's the root of iniquity. And we have to ask the Lord to save us from all that. Now, what if I don't do anything about it? In talking about the latter rain, this time of refreshing, when the sins would be blotted out, Ellen White wrote, this is in 1891, she wrote in the Review and Herald, March 17, 1891, and she wrote and told Seventh-day Adventists that we were in danger of having an experience like Judas. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't know how many times I've prayed. There's a dual prayer that I started praying many, many years ago, and I pray it often, even today. I say, Lord, there's two things. Please, when I'm under test and trial, please help me not to pull a stunt like Peter did deny my Lord. And please help me not to do even worse, like Judas, to betray my Lord. Now you may say that, well, I could never do anything like that. Well, that's what Peter said too. He said he could never do anything like that. And Judas didn't think he could do anything like that. I could do things that I don't think I can do. And when I started realizing that, I got scared and I said, Lord, you need to keep me. You need to keep me so that in a time of test, I don't become a Peter or a Judas. And Ellen White wrote and said, we're in danger of becoming like Judas. Here's what she wrote. Those who profess to be the followers of Christ are in danger of taking a course similar to that of Judas. If they do not hourly make Christ their strength and through His grace become overcomers, their unlikeness to Christ is strengthening. Their evil habits are confirming. Those who are spiritually proud, selfish, and stubborn may now make diligent work in repentance, and their sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. The precious light shining upon us shone upon the disciples, for it came through them to us, and it is of the same value today as in the early days of Christianity. Christ did not compel Judas to receive the light. Neither will He compel us to receive it. The Lord sends His servants to open the treasures of truth for the understanding of all who will accept evidence. But if men choose to cherish their own notions and resist the truth, refusing to be sanctified through it, their hearts will become hard and unimpressionable. You see, friend, it is not enough for me or for you to know the truth intellectually. That's not enough. I have to be sanctified by it. Now, let's just think this through. What is the difference between simply knowing the truth and being sanctified by the truth? Let me try to explain it this way. What I'm going to tell you is real. It's true. It's right here in Wichita. Right here in Wichita, there are many, many people. The reason I know this is because I visited them in their homes, and some of them have come to our prophecy seminars. And there are many people right here in Wichita that if you talk to them, they know that the seventh day is the Sabbath. And they believe it. And they won't argue with you about it. They know it, and they believe it. But they are not sanctified by the truth. You know why? Because they're not keeping the Sabbath. You see, you're not sanctified by the truth just because you know it unless you obey what you know, unless you do what you know. It's that way with any other truth. I remember this man's dead now, and I'm not going to tell you his name because wouldn't want to cast any reflection on him at all. But I'm just going to tell you as an illustration so you understand. This happened many years ago. It happened in my father-in-law's house. It was Sabbath. We were eating lunch. My father-in-law often, he was a person that had hospitality. And he often invited many people to his house. And my wife and I were at my father-in-law's house. And there were so many people there wasn't room enough for the table. So a physician and myself were eating lunch together. And we were just sitting on the carpet, on the floor, because there were not enough chairs and things around, because there's a lot of people there. So it wasn't paper plate. We had a hard plate, and in our hand, we were eating. Well, this physician, we were just sitting there visiting. He felt a little bit uncomfortable. Now, I didn't say anything. I was just being friendly, didn't say anything. But he felt a little bit uncomfortable, and the reason he felt uncomfortable was he was, I would say, in the neighborhood of 200 pounds overweight, somewhere in that neighborhood. His wife was only about 150 pounds overweight, but he was probably 200. And he felt self-conscious about it. He and I were eating just real close together, just sitting on the floor. I didn't say anything about it, but he decided he had to explain the situation. So he told me, he said, I decided that I would rather be fat than hungry all the time. So it's fat. Well, I didn't say anything. However, when I was thinking about that, we went home later. I told my wife when we got home, I said, you know, I think I'd rather be hungry 24 hours a day than be in the condition that poor man's in. And this man knew everything I knew, I think, about health. He was a physician. He understood about diet. And he understood all about the dangers of obesity and heart disease and cancer and all that sort of thing. He understood all that. But you see, knowing something and experiencing it is not necessarily the same thing. So it's not enough for you and for me to know what the truth is. We have to actually live it or practice it. That's what it means to be sanctified by the truth. She says here, it's not enough to know it. We have to be sanctified through it. And if we do that, what'll happen? Well, here's what could happen. It says, if the truth we profess to believe does not change the heart and transform the character, it is of no value to us. If the same defects of character remain in us after we have a knowledge of the truth, if pride, self-esteem, self-sufficiency, evil thinking, evil surmising, evil speaking still continue, if we judge those with whom we come in contact, we are not becoming sanctified through the truth and will have no part with Christ in His kingdom. And that's plain, isn't it? If I know the truth, but it doesn't work any change in me, well then, I'm not sanctified through it. It's not just knowing intellectually the truth, it's actually living it or experiencing it so that I'm sanctified. The truth will sanctify me if I live it out. Friends, I can't do it for you, and you can't do it for me. We're each going to have to go to the Lord and say, Lord, search my heart. Is there anything in the way I'm thinking or in the way I'm feeling or in the way that I talk with other people in my family? By the way, the Christian religion begins in your family. If you're not a Christian at home, you're not a Christian, period. But then the church becomes your extended family, and then after that, if we can be a Christian at home and a Christian at church, then we can be a Christian to the world. Christianity begins in our family. The way I speak, the way I feel, the way I talk, the way I act toward the members of my family, is it the way they do in heaven or not? She says, the Lord will deal with us as we deal with others. This is Review and Herald, October 31, 1893. The Lord will deal with us as we deal with others. Have we dealt unkindly, unjustly, with the brethren, with the world, then it is for us to make confession, repent, and be converted, that our sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Over and over again, as I've searched these statements during the Spirit of Prophecy, over and over again, now there's another one where she talks about we need to search our hearts, and then we need to say, if we find something, we need to confess it and repent of it, forsake it, and say, Lord, work a miracle in my heart through your Holy Spirit, so that a change takes place, so that when the times of refreshing come, my sins are blotted out. Remember, you and I, none of us, we're not going to heaven unless our sins are blotted out. And our sins will not be blotted out if they have not been repented of and confessed and forsaken. That's what Peter said in Acts 3. We're just so dull of mind that the Spirit of Prophecy repeats it over and over again in a different kind of language, so we get the point. The expression, repent and be converted, actually covers everything, but we don't comprehend what it covers. So the Lord explains it in more simple language. It involves how you speak to people. It involves how you deal with people in business. It involves how you feel toward other people in your family. It involves your actions, of course, but it involves your feelings and your speech, as well as your actions. Here's another statement on this in Review and Herald, April 9, 1895. Do not sleep now on the very brink of the eternal world. Obtain the experience where you will hate the things which you once loved and love that which you once hated, where you will count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. She says, goes on to say in that statement, if you do that, when the times of refreshing will come, your sins will be blotted out. Here's a few other things that we need to look at for ourselves. This signs the time, July 25, 1892. What excuse can you offer to God that you have had a murmuring spirit? If I have a murmuring spirit, I can't go to heaven. Are you all aware of the fact that Ellen White says that when Jesus went to the cross, I was so astonished when I read that I could just go to fall on the floor. She said when Christ went to the cross, he did not even have a discontented or murmuring thought. I couldn't take it in. I was just flabbergasted. So if I have a murmuring spirit, by the way, if you have a murmuring spirit, something's going to happen. You're going to get to murmuring sometime. That's what happened to the children of Israel, kept them out of Canaan. Do I have a murmuring spirit? She says, you have represented your Savior to the world as a hard master. Have you been exacting and severe with others, domineering over those that were under your control? She goes on in this statement to talk about how have you manifested cruelty to animals, cruelty to dumb creatures. Jesus never was cruel, not even to animals. Ellen White says he would stop to pick up and help an injured bird. She says that in Desire of Ages. If we're getting ready to go to heaven, we must become like Jesus is. We have to. We have to ask the Lord to change us. When I was a child, my mother said, you know, either this boy is, he's either going to become like Hitler, or he's going to be converted and be changed. Well, I decided I wanted to be changed. How about you? The Lord can change you. The Lord can change me. If we ask him, say, Lord, I want you to change my heart through your Holy Spirit so that when the sins are blotted out, I'll be ready to have my sins blotted out. I'll read this one last time. I read this statement already. What will happen when sins are blotted out? When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, then the sins of the repentant soul who received the grace of Christ and has overcome through the blood of the Lamb will be removed from the records of heaven and will be placed upon Satan, the scapegoat, the originator of sin, and be remembered no more against him forever. But if that's going to happen, any sin that is on the books of record on my account, I have to repent and I have to confess so that my sins will be blotted out. Friend, I want not just for my sins to be blotted out, I want for the sins of the people in this church to be blotted out. Now, it would be nice if the sins of the people in the whole world could be blotted out, but it's not going to happen. You know it's not going to happen. But it could happen for you. You're a Christian. You decided to follow the Lord. Your sins could be blotted out. If you don't act like Judas, say, Lord, is there any wicked way in me? Is the way I deal with my family, the way I deal with people that I work with, the way I deal with people in the church, am I really Christ-like or am I just a pretend Christian? Say, Lord, show me. Is there something that needs to be changed? Is there something I haven't even thought about that I need to confess, that I need to make right? Show me what it is. Let me tell you, I can tell you this much from experience. If you start to pray that prayer, the Lord will answer. You'll have things that come to your mind that you know that you need to straighten out, that you need to make right, so that you'll be ready. Because the time's coming. When the time of refreshing comes, the sins are going to be blotted out. And when that happens, just, I don't know how long the time is, but it'd be a very short time. Sure, somebody says, we have to go through the time of trouble. Yes, that's a very, very short time. If your sins will be blotted out, you'll make it through the time of trouble. If your sins are not blotted out, you got a lot to fear about the time of trouble. Well, I hope you'll spend some time to study these things out on your own and go to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, show me if there's any wicked way in me. Let's pray before we go. Father in heaven, I pray for each person here. Lord, you know our hearts. You know all about us. And Lord, we have a tendency to forget and become lackadaisical and not realize that we need to be reviewing. We need to be investigating our own minds, our thoughts, and our feelings, and asking you if there's anything in us that is not pleasing in your sight, that is not the way it is should be in heaven, is not the way it will be in heaven. Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will point out to each one of us those things in our character, in our thoughts, in our feelings that need to be changed, so that our speech can be changed and so that we can be ready for Jesus to come, so that we can be ready for our sins to be blotted out. Lord, I pray for each member of this church that when that time comes, that our sins may be blotted out and that we may be accounted part of the New Jerusalem, part of the kingdom that is coming. We pray this in Jesus' name for His sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.